Hi, I'm Jason Gorby from ThatShelf.com, and we're here to talk about portable music players, PMPs, and why the heck would you need one in the day and age when everyone's got a cell phone?
They change.
Look, I'm a child of the 80s, I was a teenager in the 80s, and everyone craved the Walkman when Sony actually miniaturized one of their actual units that was designed for reporting and crunched into a small size. Everybody could, for the first time really, take pretty decent high quality audio on the road with them with just a couple AA batteries, and they'd actually be rocking it. I still have my old Walkman here. This was by no means my first, and it's a little bit beat up, but this baby with Dolby BNR and a whole bunch of digital layouts and stuff like this was sort of towards the tail end of the Walkman life, but I love this. It was the only thing that I really listened to cassette on. I never bought cassettes. What I would do is I would buy records from Columbia House or otherwise, or I would buy CDs and then make mixtapes out of them. That's how I did my portables. It was always when you were making your own tapes, especially using metal or sort of more premium cassettes, you could actually get pretty decent sound out of one of these. This is by no means one of the crazy high-end collectible ones, but nonetheless, it served me many, many years and did very well. Auto reverse, it had all the bells and whistles. This was the sort of cassette deck that I saved up for a lot, and I remember when I bought it at Yorkdale Mall, I believe. There was this cabinet full of exotic Walkman that I'd never seen the designs, anything like it before. I remember it was one of those first sort of almost an audio fetishization that began a very, very long and dangerous path. In and around the device that sort of saw the demise of the cassette tape was the compact disc, of course. And I had many Discmen. I had the car Discman, which actually had better anti-skip technology. Unfortunately, I don't have that anymore. But the ability to actually use a cassette adapter and put it into the cassette deck on your system, have a cable come into your Discman, just allowed CD on the go, again, in the car, which was a real thrill. The last portable CD player I bought was actually, for me, a pretty big deal. This is the iRiver Slim X. This is one of the first units that was ever sold that actually allowed you to play CDs and MP3s. So that on here, each CD, you know, each cassette contained 60 to 90 minutes, each CD somewhere around 74 minutes maximum. But with this, I could actually burn a disc, a 640 megabyte disc, with a gazillion MP3s on them, and with this player actually play it sort of as a portable MP3 player. I was much more interested in this than what was taking place with the Apple devices at the time. When the first iPod came out, I believe it only had 5 gigs worth of storage, and it just felt a little clunky, and I liked the ability for me to play real CDs on it as well as any MP3 mixes. And more importantly, for those that don't remember how long it took to actually put your music onto your device, I could have 5 or 6 MP3 discs that would have many, many more songs on it than anything that I could actually fit in on an iPod. When I eventually did buy an iPod, I sort of waited. I waited for them to have an 80 gig, and this is my 160 gig model that I still have kicking around. I really love this device. This really was the sort of tail end of the iPod. The click wheel finally got solidified. They got rid of a bunch of the buttons. But this, with 160 gig, gave me a quick enough processor that I could actually navigate through a music collection of this size. Again, most people who were listening to music at the time would have an iPod and they would just, you know, chuck on a few songs here or there, you know, a few hundred songs. I clearly like a lot of music, and my dream was always to have all of my music with me all the time. With CD, I moved to Europe for a year, and I brought a case with 200 actual CDs in it. That's what I had to do, and that was just in the mid-90s. By the time the late 90s happened, you could get something like this that would have the vast majority of that in your pocket. But the fact of the matter is that the iPod, with its ridiculous connector, it was pretty nice that you could actually put it in certain things that actually allowed the 30-pin to work, but it was all proprietary, and just as somebody that wasn't fully baked into the Apple ecosystem, it was a little bit annoying. iTunes has always been flaky to this day. And so the music management on this was never quite what I wanted it to be. I did all kinds of other options along the way. My car actually allowed me to have an external hard drive at some point in time, just a regular USB input, and so I could get 500 gig on a mini laptop size hard drive and then have, again, a gazillion songs. But I was also interested in how the stuff actually sounded. MP3 through one of these was fine, but if you had decent enough headphones, the headphone amp on here wasn't particularly spectacular. And the fact of the matter is, you get what sort of you're going to get out of this. Even at 320 or V0 MP3, you're just not going to get quite the same musical impact as something like this. Now, that's not to say that MP3s can't sound fantastic, especially for some types of music, particularly over-processed songs that have been produced all to hell. The difference is pretty minimal, but if you're listening to anything that's sort of straight up acoustic, it's the stuff like when a drummer hits a cymbal and you actually hear the cascade of all the transients taking place there. That's really where you start hearing it. It's subtle, but the better the headphones you have plugging into this, the worse this sounds. It's one of those things. When they canceled this and everybody went to actually using basically the iPhone as their, or their whatever other mobile phone, but Apple in particular said, we don't really need to have iPods, we can have iPod minis, but we're gonna get rid of the iPod Classic and basically say, we don't care about your own music collection, we're gonna go with Apple Music, which means you're in a subscription service, which means you're completely tied to the music that they have. So different versions, different iterations, different CD pressings, all of that goes away when you're all getting it all from streaming. Now I'm a huge, huge fan of Spotify. I think Spotify, as a listener, I know how disastrous it is to the artists, and so there absolutely is ambivalence here. But in terms of any of the streaming services, even above and beyond movie streaming services, I have gotten much more out of having Spotify than I have almost anything else. The ability to really look up something at a moment's notice and see whatever records has shaped not only for me discovering music, but also for me to check out things before I actually purchase them. So I got no problem with streaming, and one of the great things that has been able to be done with mobile phones is the streaming services. Before that happened though, you were still copying MP3s to your phone. And at that time I found that just too much of a pain in the butt. The phones that I was getting had okay digital to analog converters or DACs inside them. But I decided that I wanted to have something that was a little bit more robust. And thus I got my first Fiio. This is a Fiio X5, which obviously, you know where they got the design mentality from. But this Fiio X5, which came out, I don't know, years ago anyway, has two micro SD slots on the bottom. Now at the time, I believe I could get 100 gig. So I could have 200 gig on here. Basically, this is 180, I could have 200 gig on here, but with extra cards, which ran about $100 each, I could actually have this full of MP3s, pop it in, pop it out, and be good to go. But what was fantastic about this player, it's got a scroll wheel, it's like an old school iPod in the sense that it actually still has the buttons, so that when you're doing it quickly, you can actually navigate it really, really in a speedy way, have the buttons on the side. In other words, all the stuff that Steve Jobs hated for his total minimalist aesthetic, you basically have the things that you really want. If you want to turn up the volume, you don't have to sort of play with it. You just could immediately go right into the volume and get it taken care of. Now, this sounded great. I was really happy with it. It was a little bit clunky and a little bit slow and used its own OS. But nonetheless, this was my player for, again, many years. I really enjoyed it. It was a fantastic portable player. After this, I sort of went in two directions. I absolutely would use my mobile phone, especially on planes and stuff like that. It was just, frankly, more convenient sometimes than bringing another device. But when I brought another device, I brought one I'll show you in a moment, but the pain, and everybody knows this, is that most devices now have gotten rid of the headphone jack. This is a Google Pixel, and the fact of the matter is that there's no headphone jack on here. You actually need to have, in this case, a USB-C to headphone adapter. That itself, just that little dongle itself, basically becomes your DAC, converting the USB signal into an analog signal, which is why the replacement adapter is like $30. This was fine, but more a grand version of a player. If I wanted to actually play DSD files, which are the equivalent of Super Audio CD files, or high resolution FLAX, I looked at many devices. I looked at Fiio. I wasn't really happy with them. I actually picked up an Astral and Kern very briefly, a very expensive one, just to try out, and I really wasn't happy about how it navigated back in the day. The one that I actually found that I really enjoyed was the Onkyo. So this is a beautiful unit, a strange monolithic design, nice volume connector here, gold plated headphone jacks on the top, and you'll notice two kinds of headphone jacks up here. You have one that is a regular 3.5 millimeter, or, you know, normal headphone jack, mini jack, and the other one's a much tinier hole, and that is for a 2.5 millimeter balance jack. Now, what the heck does that mean? Well, balance basically means, obviously, the signal is being sent instead of being sent using the grounding of the cable. It basically sends the signal individually on each wire, essentially. So each ear is getting its own distinguished signal. It means that the noise will hypothetically cancel out because anything that's identical in both signals gets replaced, and you're basically getting the purest signal that you can possibly get, especially from something for something like headphones where you're really hearing every sort of minutia. What's also nice about bounce is it actually ups the audible volume a little bit based on the way the signal works. I don't pretend to be an electronics engineer or electrical engineer, but nonetheless, bounce better. Bounce certainly makes a difference when it comes to headphones, and for there to be a bounce output is good. Now, this was the DPX1A. The original version of the DPX1 actually had quite a number of issues with, including how they actually built these top inputs. They didn't have very much structure on here at all, and because of the way that the actual jack work, you have so much tension on here that it would actually snap on the inside. I actually managed to replace it with this one. This one's in 100% working order, and it's been very, very good. You know, but inevitably you start getting itchy for something much more powerful. Now, the headphones that I was using with this and a few of the others were these, which are originally had Shure, I believe they're 525s, but these are Shure 846 in-ear headphones. They have these sort of gnarly things that I actually got custom made so that they actually fit directly to the ear, like musician monitors. But if you actually look at these headphones here, that's the headphone. And that headphone has, I believe, four drivers, including one that's an actual subwoofer. And this little eggy thing is incredible. It is an engineering marvel and one of many high-end IEMs, in-ear monitors, made from numerous manufacturers. Now, people get into all kinds of esoteric ones. You go online, you find all kinds of nonsense when it comes to headphones, that's for sure. People liking different things for different things they listen to. Nonetheless, I really appreciated the Shure as a very prominent manufacturer, obviously, of musical equipment, microphones, etc. Nonetheless, these were and are my go-to IEMs. I love them. In terms of other headphones, I've had Sennheisers since I was a kid. We actually had a pair of HD600s, which I still have, this old gold rim pair. It was the first time I'd ever really heard good headphones and the sort of immersing yourself in there. From there, I bought a number of pairs. I have an HD25, which are the closed capsule ones, which are fantastic when you're on a plane or subway or anything like that back when we would travel. But the HD25s, what's remarkable about them is basically wearing earmuffs. I am not a fan of noise canceling, which basically has a microphone on the outside and is blasting anti-noise in it. It's hypothetically trying to get rid of, it's sending an inverse signal to whatever it represents as outside noise. And so it's basically blasting your ears with that. I'm not a fan. I never find that it works particularly well, especially compared to something like HD25s that completely seal it. Or when I have these monsters in, I've had screaming babies beside me and you can't hear a thing with them. Now, the opposite is true when I finally got my sort of dream over-the-ear headphones, which are these. These are Sennheiser HD800Ss. These monster things completely open back. When I play these, everybody in the room can hear exactly what it is that I'm playing. These are often complained about by some people for being too neutral or too accurate. You get headphone people saying, oh, I just wish it was a little bit more this or a little bit more that. These are basically whatever the hell the audio file is, this is what you're getting out of it. And as somebody that actually really enjoys that whole notion of just give me what's there and then I can decide whether the thing sounds good or not, reason that I calibrate my television, I don't mess with all the various modes, and it's why I actually like the neutral sound of something like the Sennheiser and even the 846s, which themselves are relatively neutral. So, to drive something like this, the Onkyo will absolutely be able to drive them to a certain extent. You obviously need a lot more energy coming out of here than driving little things like this. Forget the fact that this is on a Bluetooth adapter, that's a whole nother conversation. But when I take these cables off and actually plug them directly in using a balanced cable, you actually get more than enough impact out of something like the Onkyo. But with the HD800S, it's a little bit weak. You basically have to crank this to full volume, and then it feels like it's working a little bit too hard to get the signal out of here onto these headphones, which is why I was looking for something that gave me a little bit more bang for my buck. And what I looked at is going back to the manufacturers that made this guy. So we had iRiver out of Korea, the first MP3 CD player. We had Fiio, the Chinese company that sort of took over and tried to replicate what iPod had done. Obviously Sony, the Japanese company that sort of initiated the whole portable boom. And now we have once again, going back to our friends at Fiio. This is the Fiio M15, which is a beast of a player. It's essentially the equivalent of buying a very high-end component for your stereo system, except you can take it along with you. The Onkyo, again, had a huge benefit for me that it actually had two slots. So it actually allowed me to have two micro SD cards in here, so I could have oodles of storage space on here. Back when I bought this, the biggest card you could get was 200 gigs, so I could have 400 gig of MP3s or FLAC or DSD files on here, plus I believe 60 gig built into this. The M15, unfortunately for me, only includes one slot, but fortunately for me, the cards themselves have expanded and the price has actually gone down, as it does with memory all the time. So you can get a 512 card now, 512 gig card, replacing my two cards in this one for less than $100. The M15, as I said, is essentially Fiio engineers just going nuts. Just saying, what is the best thing that we can build, given all the limitations, given all the stuff that we have to do to make something into a portable device? How can we take something that would normally be a monster unit, that this basically has the same specs of things that sell for $6,000 to $10,000 that you would actually have as part of your stereo system? How can we put it into a portable unit and actually make it work? Well, they did it with the M15. It's absolutely remarkable. Again, it's a direct competition to Astell and Kern, who is, again, a very high-end manufacturer. But I've always found their stuff really expensive and really kind of obnoxious. Yes, they're very good, but it's a level that I just find a little bit smarmy, for lack of a better word. I like where I can get the biggest bang for my buck, where I'm sure that the engineers have put in absolute the best efforts that they can, but I'm not paying thousands more for something just so I can have a badge that says A&K on it. Nonetheless, let's look inside what we got with the Fiio. This just showed up. Plain cardboard box contains within it this. And you know, when you actually have this kind of unboxing, let's do this carefully. It's always amusing to me how these guys take some of the ritual that you get with vinyl, you know, taking out of the sleeve, being careful with it, cleaning it, doing whatever you got to do, and they sort of put it into just the unpackaging, the first unpackaging of the box. So here's the Fiio M15, beautiful shiny outer box, and inside, again, very much like opening sort of a record, we have boxes within boxes within boxes. So in this embossed element here, and as I open this up, again, it's like one of those nesting dolls. Petrushka doll? You have this, a wooden box with an obi around it, a strip, little holographic sticker just to remind you that this thing is official. So inside this, as I strip it off, inside the wooden box, I have here the unit. It's proudly displaying that on the inside, here we are, the Fiio M15. It's probably displaying on the outside with a sticker that it's got dual AK4499 EQ chips. These are the heart of the beast. It's dual DAC. In other words, each channel has its own digital audio converter, digital analog converter, excuse me, to actually give the best possible sound that you can, regardless of size or expense. Really, these AK4499 chips are the best of the best, and the fact that they've crammed them into a unit like this and actually managed to make it work and still be battery powered is quite remarkable. Now, the thing is not light. It definitely feels like a brick. It's heavier than everything that I've touched here, including my old Walkman. Nonetheless, it definitely feels wonderful and substantial, and like you're really getting something for what you paid for. As I take off the outside plastic, I'm always amused how some people actually leave this stuff on. On the back, it shows high-res audio, the sort of symbol that we've seen, I think Sony introduces, regardless. And again, showing that it plays off what you want, that it's not just a regular run-of-the-mill MP3 player. Nobody's going to look at this. They're just going to think it's a ridiculous and fancy phone. And I take off this outer layer, and we already have all kinds of smush on here as I was playing with it earlier. But nonetheless, that's the unit. On the bottom, which I'm very pleased to see, is a USB-C charger. For many of you will know this, obviously, but USB-C actually allows it to charge not only much more quickly, but it's a much more robust connector. If I go back to my Onkyo over here, it has one of those micro USB inputs on the bottom, which there's a right way and a wrong way to plug it in. It's a bit of a schlep. But also, you just always feel, again, that whole torsion thing, that the connectors themselves were never quite as robust. I find with USB-C, even though you have the same, hypothetically, the ability to auger out the mechanism, it just feels more robust when it actually connects. It feels like there's more meat there to hold on to, as it were. On the bottom is a bit of a tease. You actually have here where the micro SD card goes in, and on the other side is a mirrored version that basically just shows the model number. I would have loved if they would have had a card slot here and a card slot here. They didn't do that for me. And if you look at the top, this is also the most strange thing. People are looking at it like, why are there three holes here? I mean, with the Onkyo, it was weird enough to look at two headphone jacks, but here we have three holes. And you can see the size difference isn't enormous. The fact is, this is much lighter and much thinner, but the Fiio, much more robust, much heavier. The reason that there's three is that since the Onkyo came out, there's another format that they do for balance. Instead of going for the 2.5 millimeter, they actually go for a 4.5 millimeter. What's nice about this player is that I basically then have the ability to plug in the larger plug, the 4.5, or the 2.5, or a regular 3.5 stereo, run-of-the-mill stereo. Or, of course, like the Onkyo, like my phone, it works with Bluetooth. Not only that, this has Bluetooth 5. This is lossless Bluetooth. It has aptX HD. It has all this crazy Bluetooth technology built into here. This is a ridiculously good Bluetooth sender, as good as anything that you can get on any computer anywhere, all built into here. Now, above and beyond it being a player, it's of course an Android device, as is the Onkyo. They basically use sort of dumbed down older versions of Android that have been customized to remove a lot of the phone nonsense and just use it as the operating system, so they don't have to do a custom operating system. The issue with my X5, which this thing actually had, because it was a custom operating system, it was a little bit of a pain in the ass in terms of updates and got a little bit slow and clunky. Whereas this, as long as they don't have to do all the software development, they just have to do a single app development, and then they are good to go. Fact of the matter is here, even the wallpaper here, you actually see the AKM, you actually have a really nice design here of the board on the inside. I load up Fiio Music, and what's in here is, at the moment, I have a 512 card in here, 512 gig card in here. At the moment, I have oodles and oodles and oodles of songs available here. The volume jack is on the top. You might have seen it earlier when it's charging or when it's starting up, it actually lights up blue. This is an analog volume controller, which again, in something this small, this is usually digital. This is usually not something that they would go to the extent of making it work with a full analog setup on here. They would have a digital stage in between to actually have it behave that way. But they went through the extra engineering prowess to be able to actually incorporate it without adding any additional distortion or any additional noise. The thing is silent in its operation. You get no clicking, no nonsense like that when you're going up and down. It's as good as any volume controllers as I've ever had. And ridiculously, that actually matters. When you're having something like this, and again, you have very sensitive headphones, you're gonna hear the issue. You're gonna hear any hissing. You're gonna hear any problems. As I said before, with IEMs, I am not worried about this driving it. Frankly, my phone can drive my in-ear monitors pretty well. If you actually drag down here, you have many options that you can change here, including the over-the-ear mode versus the regular mode. Over-the-ear mode basically puts out more current in order to drive something like these beasts. So if I just take this and plug it in, you can see I have the 2.5 millimeter version of my cable. It's the middle. Once plugged in, that's it. Very secure. Absolutely rock solid here. I see no give whatsoever. The Onkyo, you always felt a little bit like the input wasn't quite as robustly constructed as this. Absolutely rock solid. And I've been listening to a few things over the last couple hours, and it's been absolutely amazing. I have yet to play with the 846s. That'll be very interesting for me as I go portable. But nonetheless, I've thoroughly enjoyed listening to it. The fact of the matter is, to drive these beats, it is substantially more current coming out of here compared to the Onkyo. The Onkyo, I would have to be at pretty close to full volume to get sort of that robust sound and imaging that you get out of these headphones. With this, I can be about 70-80% and get almost the same amount of sound out as I was with the Onkyo. Absolutely amazing. On the side here, we have a hold button, of course, and then we have all the controller buttons. We got a play, a pause, we have a track listing, we have a power, and we have this programmable key that you can hit. Now, as this all goes along, you have Gorilla Glass on either side, on the front and the back. I can see just by handling it, it's getting all kinds of fingerprints, which is a little bit of a slap. And so, what do we end up doing? Well, just like with the Onkyo, you buy a case for it. So, I went ahead and got that. And the way that the Fiio cases tend to work, it's nice that they're official ones now. They used to actually come out with this like silicone sort of rubbery thing, which was, you know, not so great, especially with something like this, because the units would definitely heat up. Now on this beast, it has amazing battery life compared to what I'm used to. One of the things about the Onkyo is it took forever to charge, it felt. This obviously charges faster because of USB-C, but it'll actually hold a charge. Apparently this will hold a charge for months, which is fantastic. You're not always remembering to charge it if you're not using it, or if I'm using it on a portable device and then I go pick it up. I just want it to work if it hasn't been plugged in for a while. And that's one of the big advantages of this. The fact of the matter is this thing will get hot. Just, it's got so much processing going on that it's just one of the things, one of the limitations about it. The fact of the matter is it has one remarkable ability, which is to convert everything when it's converting from digital analog, from basically whatever the WAV file is, FLAC, whatever PCM file, to DSD. Now there's a whole longer conversation about its advantages, but essentially what it's doing is it's taking a digital-to-digital step to DSD, because the conversion from DSD to analog provides an ability to create a much smoother and much more liquid soundstage from that digital file. So if you go through that extra process of going basically from PCM to DSD to analog, you get a better sound. It just sounds better, more accurate to what was actually recorded, especially for, again, those original analog recordings. When that is on here, it means the battery gets eaten up a little bit quicker, but also means that it heats up. So any case that I actually get for this, I want to make sure that it'll actually allow for sufficient cooling. And our friends at Fiio actually went ahead and did that. Got to figure out how this baby opens. There's always something here. Just a regular box. There we go. All this to have a wonderful box on the inside. Also that I can have an outer leather case. Now, is this ridiculous? Of course it's ridiculous. Of course the whole thing is a bit insane that I have to buy a case for this, but we all know that how that works with our phones. But if you see, I smell cow. If you see how it's actually constructed, the back is protecting, but allows significant amounts of cooling. It actually has, I believe these are aluminum, cooling vanes on the back, which allows for protection, but cooling at the same time. The top, you actually have this nice little cover here, magnetic cover over where the volume control is. And the bottom, a significant hole for the USB charger. I look forward to that. And then actually sort of indented in leather here are the buttons that actually correspond. And of course the whole button is completely open. This will be attached into the device. I neglected to actually show what was else in this box. Lucky me, finishing the unboxing without going to all the details. So at the bottom of the box, as I take this away, we have here, you have one of these little pins that anybody who's ever put it in a SIM card into their phone knows about. Because what's actually quite nice about it, in some ways, is that the micro SD card is locked in there exactly like a SIM tray. Now, I don't know how much of an advantage that is. In some ways, it's a little bit of a pain in the ass. You have to sometimes find one of those little pinny things or use a very, very small paperclip. But nonetheless, I know it's not coming out. It's in there. And I don't have to worry about any springs getting dislodged or anything like that. So inside that is one of those. If I keep going here, we have USB A to USB-C. We have a coax adapter. I'll get into that in a sec. And then we have the rest of the documentation. Now, everything that I've been talking about with the M15 is talking about it as being a portable player. And really, that's how I'm going to be using it for 99.9% of the time. But the fact of the matter is that this thing absolutely could be put into my equipment rack and be as good, if not better, than almost anything plugged in there for digital playback. Because this beast is a standalone DAC. It is a standalone digital to analog converter that I can output from these analog outputs, including a balance. I can actually get a 4.5 to XLR, plug it into my amplifiers using this volume controller, and have this be the basically home of all digital information on my equipment, so that I have a vinyl setup and I have this as my main digital player. So this thing, which has a mini jack on one end and a coax adapter out on the other, actually allows me basically to using SPDIF, using digital signal to come directly from here into the digital input if I wanted, on a computer, on a receiver, whatever I want. In other words, this becomes a digital source in the same way I would plug in a CD player with digital out. I could actually do that with here. So what we have is the ability really to use this with a computer, and but you can get pretty damn good audio out, and then use this basically as a digital out, so that this basically goes into whatever other device you wanted and allow you to sort of cascade, take the digital information, the raw digital information out in here through SPDIF into another device. What you can also do is use a USB-C to plug it into a computer and set this up as essentially a sound card. This becomes the sound device for your computer, whatever you're listening to. I don't care if it's a YouTube video or whatever. Basically, the sound would be sent digitally directly to this unit, like a sound card, and then it would use its analog converters, digital analog converters, rather than ones built into your PC sound card. Absolutely remarkable, the fact that it can get away doing it. Again, people spend thousands of dollars to get something this good that they can hook into a PC. The fact is that this sort of works on all these multi-levels, that it can work as a standalone DAC, it can work as a digital transport, and it can work for what I'm going to be using it for, mostly as a digital audio player, something that we actually take along when we're going on walks or whatever, or more importantly, when we can actually fly again, this will be something that I'll actually be taking on the plane. So I'm super excited to dig into this. I'm super excited to put on the leather case, to actually put these beasts over my ears and give a good listen. So I hope you've enjoyed this sort of overview of my nonsensical voyage through portable playback. This is the Fiio M15, their latest flagship model. Look, they might come up with M15 Pro. There may be something that is slightly better than this. I really think this is going to be something that lasts me for many, many years to come. The Onkyo did me very well for many years. And the fact of the matter is that this is going to be the sort of touchstone for what I do when I listen to music. I should also point out, of course, since it's Android, you can play Spotify, you can play Tidal, which is ostensibly CD quality lossless. I've downloaded the Neil Young Archives application that I'm going to be running on here, so that I can get his high resolution streaming through on this unit. In other words, this becomes both my computer, my digital player, and my navigator for the entire world of digital music, so that I can absolutely listen to Spotify in whatever decent quality streaming that I can get from Spotify, or I can listen to 24192 FLAC file that I put on here, or a full DSD file that we get, HD tracks FLAC files that you can purchase and get this remarkable quality, as good as you're going to get in terms of digital playback. This is a beast, and I'm very, very happy to have it during this time where we're spending a lot more time sort of indoors wanting to escape. This is my little way of getting a little bit of escape in. Thanks so much for watching this crazy long video about my journey through portable playback. I've made quite the mess here, but nonetheless, I'm really looking forward to spending many years, hopefully, with the Fiio M15. It really seems to knock off everything I've ever wanted for a player like this, something that can easily drive my 846s or my 800s with absolute ease, something that I can play Spotify on, something that I can play high resolution audio files on, something that will convert all my audio to DSD. I look forward to seeing whether or not I actually am going to use it with my PC as ostensibly a sound card. We'll see how it all works out. I don't know, I have it to play with, and Lord knows we all are spending a lot more time at home. I got more time hypothetically to play, although it seems that we've never been busier. Nonetheless, thanks so much for watching. Please subscribe, please visit thatshelf.com, ring the bell for a notification when new videos come up. Please leave some comments and let us know if you're actually enjoying these videos. I know they're a little bit weird, especially if you're not necessarily in the market for something like this, but hopefully you've enjoyed our little journey. Please follow us on social, and thanks so much for joining us here. We'll see you next video. Take care.